Welcome to this episode of the Free to Be podcast, and today I'm here with a beautiful friend called Julie Mitchell, who works as a coach and is also the founder of the Sisterhood Social, which is an incredible social activism organisation around supporting women in society. And I've known Julie for a couple of years now and have felt so inspired by the work that she does and the way that she shares her heart and soul in the work that she does. So I'm really looking forward to opening this conversation and having a discussion with you about who you are and the work that you do. So thank you so much for joining me today, Julie. I really appreciate it.
Thank you for inviting me. It is so wonderful to be in this space with you, and I'm tearing up just hearing the way that you talk about Sisterhood Social. It makes me feel emotional. Thank you for that.
It's my pleasure. It's an organisation that I've felt is needed in my life personally. I've, for a lot of years, felt a disconnect from being with other women and that experience of being vulnerable with other women and really showing ourselves to the women around us. And I feel like the work you do has really kind of helped inspire me to uncover my ability to be present with women and to feel comfortable in that naked space, because it is a naked space when you're with other women. You can't hide who you really are, because it's just all on show. So yeah, it's a wonderful organization, and I'd love to know what inspired you to want to bring it to life.
It's really interesting to hear you talk about feeling naked and vulnerable and yet safe in that space, because I think that's how I've felt around groups of women for all of my life. I've not been particularly comfortable with groups of women. And so in some ways, I kind of look at it and think it's an odd thing to have done, to have set up Sisterhood Social, which, like, you know, creates these really large gatherings of women. And I sort of look at that and go, I wonder why I did that. It seems like such an unnatural thing for me to have done. And yeah, I think when I listened to you say that, I was responding to that same need in myself. I felt that I wanted to be with women, and I wanted to be myself and allow other women to be themselves. And that was part of it. A lot of things, I think, came together in my life that created the space and the motivation to do it. So at the time, I was running my own business. I was running a tea room and catering business, and that was an adventure that I had sort of between working in higher education and then starting to work as a coach. And I posted a photograph of myself on International Women's Day in 2017, stood in my tea room. And it was a pledge of what I wanted to do as a woman for other women. And the pledge was something about speaking out against injustice, overcoming fear and resistance that I felt was around the strength of women. And I made this pledge and I didn't know what it meant, but I really felt it. So that was in the March. And then in that summer, I went to the Edinburgh Festival for the first time. It was somewhere I'd always wanted to go, and I went because a friend of mine was performing. And when I arrived in Edinburgh, he'd just seen a play called Mouthpiece, which is a feminist play by a Canadian theatre company. And he said to me, "You've got to go and see this play. I bought you a ticket. You need to go and see it," and sort of packed me off. And I remember at the time being a bit kind of like, "So you're not coming with me?" He's like, "No, I've seen it." And sort of felt a little bit affronted that I just arrived in Edinburgh and he was packing me off. And I went to see this play, and oh my goodness, it was such a powerful experience. And it was around women not feeling able to speak and literally losing their voices because they weren't able to speak their truth. And I'm feeling emotional talking about it, because I remember at the end, the whole audience were on their feet and most of us were crying. And it, the impact of it was so hard hitting. And I came out and I sat with my friend and I said, I've got to do something. I don't know what it is yet, but I've really got to do something. And shortly after that, I closed the tea room because it just wasn't feeling right for me anymore. That business didn't, I'd always known it wasn't my life's work, but it really felt as if it had kind of had its time. And took some time to see what was going to happen next. I didn't really know where I was going with it. And one day the name just came to me, Sisterhood Social, and it was kind of like, okay, this is my response. I'm going to pull together all of the experiences that I've had. I've had these experiences with this event company. You know, I've had this experience of building community in that way. I've had experiences of building community through my previous work in higher education. Now I want to do something for women. And I'm going to try and pull all those threads together. And it's going to be called Sisterhood Social. And I'm not sure exactly what it's going to look like. But it feels like it's a platform for women to hear each other and see each other and share their stories. And I think that's what it is.
It definitely comes across that way, as a platform for women to come together, be with one another and share their honest experiences about what they go through. And I want to pick up on something that you said about hearing the call and that being a response. I really love that as a form of inspiration, of doing things, just hearing something and it just like triggering something inside of you to say, I have to respond to this in some way. And I really like that approach of having an idea, seeing something and then feeling a need to respond and then creating that response for yourself. I think that's a wonderful way of approaching it. And it comes from a deep place then. It comes from you. And that's really lovely. It definitely comes across.
It does feel as if it is something that I couldn't not do. It's not necessarily been an easy thing to do, and it's definitely had its challenges, and there have definitely been times when I've been a bit daunted by it, but it really felt as if it was something that needed to be done, and that it had to be done by me. It was an idea that I felt so deep within me that I couldn't not do it, and I felt it was my responsibility to do it, and that it was my purpose to do it.
I love that. You sensed a purpose in it and felt it was your right to do it. I love that. That's beautiful.
And I think I did it as well, not kind of with any expectation on what it would be. I'd got a picture in my head of what I would like it to feel like, but I didn't feel as if it would reflect on me if it didn't work. It wasn't kind of an ego-driven thing. It was, well, this is what seems to make sense to do. We'll start out on this path and try and do it. And if we sell tickets to the events and people come and like it, we'll do some more of it. And if we don't, then there's a different way to do it. We just don't know what way it is. And I talk about we as if it was more than me, and it wasn't. And yet I think of it as a separate entity to myself. I'm just kind of in the driving seat with it.
Yeah. Oh, I understand that completely. It's an inner conversation with the self, I would call it, the inner self, and that natural intuitive guide that we all have access to that can really clearly show us the way if we quieten down and just listen to that guidance that comes to us from within. So when you say we, I kind of know who you're talking to, and I totally understand that relationship and interaction. Absolutely. And I love that. And I wonder how you feel about Sisterhood Social now in terms of having not much of a direction to start with, but just kind of feeling this call to respond. And being a few years into it, has your direction changed? Have you developed a deeper sense of kind of confirmation that that's definitely what you want to do? Like, how are you feeling around how you're moving it forward now compared to when you first started?
So when I got going with it and we had that first event, and, you know, it wasn't an immediate success. It was I planned an event date. I started to sell tickets for it. I'd not left myself enough time. I definitely felt that it was a large scale thing. The venue that we'd gone for had kind of a minimum of, I think it was 60. So I needed to sell that many tickets for the event to go ahead at that venue, because we were providing food as well. That's a big part of our gathering together, to share food. And
it's what I love about it.
It's a really beautiful thing, and the food is amazing, isn't it? Yes. If you're not there for the connection, come for the food.
Yeah.
Absolutely. My mouth's watering just thinking about it. But it was, I was getting closer, and I think I saw something like 40 tickets, and I was just kind of like, oh, am I going to keep pushing this? Or what am I going to do about it? And I remember having a conversation with my husband, Andy, and he was like, well, could you change the date? And at first, I think I went to that place that most of us go to that is connected to the ego. That's if I do that, it'll look like it's not successful, as if it's not popular. Why will people come to something that's not popular? And then I was just like, hang on, this is not about that. Let's get back to where we were with it, the reason that we're doing it, the fact it doesn't say anything about me, it is just what it is. And so I did that. We pushed it back a month. And I remember doing a live stream on Facebook, and I was just really honest. And I just said, okay, this is what we're trying to do. This is how many tickets we've sold. We can't go ahead unless we sell this many more. We're going to put it back a month. And the response to just being honest in that way was incredible. And I think what that really showed me was that was the way forward with this. There was no kind of forcing it to be something. It was going to find its own way. And as long as I was just telling the truth and showing up telling the truth, however that looked and felt to me, then that was the route to connecting with the people who it was for.
Yeah.
You know, those people would relate to that and would be attracted to that. And I think after we'd had that first event and it was really well received, I think then I did start to think, oh, maybe I'll shape this. Maybe this is something that's going to be a membership group, and it's going to be a this and a that. And, you know, all these ideas that kind of came up. And it's not any of those things as we've moved forward. You know, we're coming up to 2.5 years, I think, since we started. And it's not any of those things. And every now and again, I'll kind of sit down and go, this has got so much potential. Which direction shall we go in? Maybe we should have some mentoring and coaching scheme attached to it. Maybe we should have a business focus. Maybe we should have a mama zone. All of this stuff that comes up. And then I never actually act on that. And I think I can go to two places with that. I can say to myself, why am I not acting on this? What's wrong with me? Why am I not maximizing its potential? Why am I not putting the effort in? Or I can go to the place of, this is not what it wants to be. This is not what I'm naturally doing. This is not what it is. And then I come right back to the basics again, and I go, what is it that we want to talk about? What stories do we want to share and hear? How can we do that? Let's do that. Yeah. And then I take that step, and it starts to gather its own momentum again. I think there are other ways that I would like to share the stories. You know, we've been meeting in person, obviously, before the COVID pandemic. We've had a Gather and Zoom meeting. We took Gather and Feast and made it Gather and Zoom, all about gathering. I've just finalising a Gather and Zoom programme for this year. It would be great to think that we could meet in person later in the year, but we're kind of just holding that very lightly as an idea. It will or it won't be. But I think there's also potentially a podcast. I've been talking about that for a couple of years. I've been talking about collecting the stories of the speakers in books. It's not happened yet. I feel like it will, because the idea keeps coming up again. It keeps saying, I'm still here. I'm still waiting to be done. Are you going to do it? Are you not going to do it? And then something else comes up. So it really is finding its own way. I think the biggest lesson for me, though, has been that in setting out to create a safe space and a community that's open to all cis and trans women and non-binary people who are comfortable in spaces that are centred on women's experiences, I've been quite naive in what it means to set up that sort of safe space community. As a white cisgender woman with no disability, I've been really naive in my own privilege about what it means to set that up and to make that safe. And this year, even though Sisterhood Social has been quieter in terms of events, the learning that's been going on within myself about that has been so huge. And now I feel like I'm in a place to bring that learning into this community and make it more representative and hold a safer space.
One of the things that I adore about you is your willingness and openness to learn from your experience and to be really open about that learning. And I just love that. I love that you are growing into this process as much as everybody else is being a part of it as well. Like, you're as much a part of the space as everyone else and are learning and sharing your experiences. And as a community leader, like, I think that's such a beautiful skill and attribute to share with your community, that, you know, you're open to learning and being taught by your experiences as well. And I love that. And you challenge some fucking gritty issues.
And we don't shy away.
some really gritty issues. And I wonder if you ever have any discomfort around that, because I know that I've, in my personal experience, wanted to speak out on issues and have felt so afraid of doing so. And then I this is probably a lot of where I feel inspired by you, because I see the work that you do and you're just doing it. You're just saying stuff and, you know, saying how things are. And I just think, wow, you know, it's so inspiring and liberating to see you do that. But I wonder if you experience any discomfort around challenging those issues and social subjects.
Absolutely. 100% yes. it can be very uncomfortable. It can be quite fear inducing. And there's definitely some self-talk about who am I to be doing this. My response to that is, who am I not to be? And not in a I'm worth it as much as anybody else is, which is true, but it's not in that sense. It's, if I've got the opportunity to do it and the skills to do it and the drive to do it, who am I to not step up to that responsibility? Who am I to shy away from that and not do this work, which seems to be supporting other people? It feels as if it would be shirking a responsibility in a way. But in terms of the topics, I think if I feel afraid of it, tells me that it really needs talking about. If I'm feeling it, other people are feeling it. If other people, if I'm feeling like there's something that's not being talked about that I want to talk about, I will most certainly not be the only person that is feeling that way. So let's talk about it. And I really love the work that Brené Brown does around vulnerability and shame. And I think I have spent so much of my life as a woman feeling ashamed of parts of myself and feeling that I'm strange or weird or different in some way. And what we learn by sharing those parts of ourselves with other people is that other people feel that too. There's nothing that is, we're all this kind of unique version of human life, and yet our experiences, there's never kind of a feeling that is just unique to us. Somebody else has felt it. It might look a bit different. Their circumstances might have been different, but they felt it too, and they can connect and relate to us. But if none of us are talking about it, then that can't happen. And so I think those gritty subjects that feel tough are just crying out to be talked about, because if it feels tough and we're shying away from it because of that, then we're all kind of in this place of doubt and wondering and vulnerability with it and shame potentially with it.
Yeah.
If we share that, we see it's not just us and we're not weird and we're not wrong. Yeah. And I think there's something really powerful in personal storytelling in that way. I think on a personal level, the parts of it that I find particularly challenging is, so when I speak out at the beginning of one of our gather and feast meetings, or gather and Zoom, or if I do a live stream on our page, and I'm being very forthright about how I see something, and if I'm talking about something that I'm in the middle of learning about, like my own privilege, and I'm speaking out and I don't want to get it wrong. You know, it's natural, isn't it, I think, for us to not want to get it wrong and to not say the wrong thing. And I think there are two parts to that. One is I don't want to say something in the wrong way that might encourage other people to think that wrong thing because they see me saying it. And partly because I don't, you know, I still feel that shame when I get it wrong. But I do think that the further I get into what I think is a lifelong learning journey, learning and unlearning journey, certainly around privilege, is that, part of my taking responsibility is seeing that I will get it wrong and that's okay. And I can take responsibility for that. So that supports me, but it's taken me a lot of my life to get to that point.
Yeah. I think feeling shame is okay. It's not something that we want, but absolutely it's natural for us to feel those uncomfortable feelings when we get things wrong. Mm. And language is changing all the time. I think it's inevitable that we're going to trip up over our feet at some point in doing this kind of work of challenging, society and challenging the status quo of how things are. We're essentially walking in the dark. And so it's inevitable we're going to trip up at some point. But yeah, I think having that recognition that it's okay, and that we're all, every single one of us is on a journey of learning, even around the subject of privilege and kind of society's hierarchy, if that's the right word for it. I'm terrible with terms of, you know, what the right words to say are and political correctness. But, you know, each and every one of us is on that journey of understanding and learning and finding who we are in relation to each other. You know, it's an ongoing process. And so, yeah, I think the fact that you're even open to it, Julie, is absolutely incredible and wonderful. And I think that that in itself is a fantastic thing to offer, and to offer the space for other people to explore that within themselves too.
I think it's the only way that we get to any real change.
Yeah.
For all of us.
And I love what you said about how when you find something that feels uncomfortable, that's how you know you need to talk about it. Mm. I think I can definitely understand that in my own experience of having stories from my personal life that I've felt I couldn't talk about because of shame. And after having a realization that I'm okay and safe to be myself, I knew that telling those stories was a way of liberating myself of them and of that shame. Absolutely. Like when we share our stories with one another and share our weirdness with one another, we kind of feel more at home. Or that's how I've experienced it for myself. I feel like I'm home and I'm safe with other people. And I think that that's so important for us as a society, to feel safe with each other, not afraid of each other.
For me, I think it's around belonging. And there's something in belonging to ourselves, which then makes it feel safer to belong with others. You know, I think unless I belong to myself, I can never belong anywhere else. In my own experience, I found that to be really true. And I think another thing that is really helpful and that comes into my coaching work in a huge way and bigger all the time is around self-compassion. Everything in life is different, feels different to me when I am being compassionate to myself. And I support my clients, my coaching clients, to do that. And I think that comes through in Sisterhood Social work as well.
Yeah. I'd love to hear a little bit more about your coaching work, because I've seen you go on this journey of developing yourself as a coach. And I've seen that you've shared a coaching program called Unbecoming recently. And I just love the feel of that. I'd love for you to share a little bit about what that's about and who it's for.
It felt quite risky calling it Unbecoming, because obviously the amazing woman who is Michelle Obama had just released an incredible book, which I love listening to, called Becoming. So to go completely the other way and call a program, a coaching program that you're asking people to sign up to, Unbecoming, felt in some ways to be a rather stupid move. And also, you know, the word unbecoming, kind of, it doesn't suit you, it's unbecoming, is interesting, isn't it? And yeah, it was that thing again that I felt with Sisterhood Social, that there was nothing else that I could call it, because there was nothing else that was as truthful about what I saw that program to be and what that program is. So the way that I see it is that a lot of us spend a lot of time trying to be something other than ourselves. And we spend a lot of time trying to, you know, the way it's talked about in a lot of the coaching industry is build confidence or build resilience or find it, as if we've not got it. And I don't believe that to be true. I think it's the complete opposite of that. I think we are confidence and resilience. It's all part of who we all are as humans, but it gets covered up, and it doesn't get covered up on purpose. It gets covered up through the society that we live in. It gets covered up through our socialization. It gets covered up through our experiences and the habitual thinking that we have around those experiences. And we collect labels of behaviors and we think we are that person, and we collect labels of roles that we do. You know, I'm a mom, I'm a wife, I'm a daughter, I'm a friend, I'm a this, I'm a that. And I think all of those things kind of add layers onto us and cover up who we truly are beneath all of that. And so Unbecoming for me means to loosen our grip on those labels and to look at what lies underneath them. So it's quite a vulnerable space to be in again, because it's taking a really honest look at our lives and who we are and who we think we are. And is that true? Is that not true? And a real kind of pouring into ourselves and having a look at what is there in a really self-compassionate way. Putting down the need to beat ourselves up for not getting the to-do list done or for what we did 20 years ago. Or, you know, it's about being with ourselves, with all of the feelings, whether they're comfortable or not. And it's about saying, I did what I could with where I was then. And now I'm doing what I can with where I am now. And sometimes that might look rubbish and not be what we want it to be at all. But it's where we're at. And I couldn't find anything that fitted better than Unbecoming.
It's, yeah, it definitely has that ring to it and speaks to me about self-forgiveness, compassion, understanding, acceptance, and kind of that understanding that when we're not trying to become, we are already.
Yeah.
And absolutely. How beautiful is that space of just being?
Yeah.
And everything comes from there.
Yeah.
You know, all of those beautiful qualities that you spoke about, confidence, resilience, strength, it all comes from that.
Yeah. Simple, it's all there, simple, isn't it? It's all there.
Yeah.
It's all there, whether we see it and feel it. And it doesn't mean that we do this unbecoming process and then it's there and it's always kind of visible to us and we feel it 100% and we're kind of fixed in that way. There is no fixing. It's seeing that it's there and building the trust that it's always there, even when we don't feel it.
Yeah.
You know, the tagline for it is Unbecoming, Returning Home to Ourselves. And it speaks to everything, I think, that we've talked about so far.
It does. Wonderful. Well, when I share this, I'll add some links for anyone who's interested in learning more about it. So I'd love it if you could send those through to me so I can include
Fantastic.
Them.
Yeah, I'd love to do that. I'm about to launch what I'm calling the Self-Compassion Hub as well. And this is a really new idea, but it's as I've become more and more focused on self-compassion. And I've seen that that's kind of the foundation of everything else that I'm doing. And that's going to be a kind of drop-in, pay-as-you-go, weekly Zoom call. Turn up when you need it, when you don't need to, you know. Yeah. But it's just finding ways, I think, to make coaching and supporting more accessible.
Yeah.
Because it's really expensive and the people, those of us that really need it, often can't afford it. You know, yeah. We could benefit from it, but we can't afford it. So it's about finding different ways to make it more accessible.
It's wonderful that you're able to offer that. And I'll definitely share some links for how people can get in touch with you to learn more about that.
Fab.
Julie, this has been an absolute pleasure. I've really enjoyed talking to you. And I wonder if there's anything else that you would like to share before we end the episode for today.
It's gone so quickly. It's been fabulous. I could talk to you all day long,
Same.
Each and every day. It's
Same.
Just amazing it's being so nice. In your company. I think what I'm going to share is a quote that I shared at one of the Sisterhood Social events that we had, not last year, the year before. And it's from this book, which is called The She Book. It's a very short quote. This She Book is written by Tanya Markle. And let me just find the quote. Okay. Let the story of who you were send shivers down the spines of your granddaughters. Let them hear about you as the woman who was herself, who did her thing and helped others along the way.
Beautiful. Perfect. Thank you.
Thank you
so
my love.
Much.
Thank
it's been
you.
Lovely to talk to you and I'll look forward to seeing you again soon.
Lots of love.
Lots of love to you too.
Bye.
Bye.